loud.
No.
Okay.
No, it's the angle. I'm wondering if that's an issue. I'm just hearing.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
Can't do you.
Hallelujah!
You have a good time last night, going to the real life. What about Thursday night?
Yes.
Lord.
Come on.
We're looking for the Lord to be here. He's already in the house.
Yes, he is.
Bruce will bring the fire tonight. Probably the last two nights. Lord's gonna rain down upon this house with everything he's got. We're gonna see him smack. This is Full Gospel Fellowship Church, Fort Meade. I'm Pastor Robert. We have a good group here tonight. We had one last night. We had one night before that. Wherever they go, they have a good night.
Amen.
Well, I'm going to ask Brother Alan Lewis if he will open us up with prayer tonight.
Thank you tonight for the opportunity to be here, Lord. We ask you, God, that you'd have your own way. Move by your Holy Spirit. We open our minds and our hearts, Lord, that your Spirit, Lord, be introduced into us, oh God, that you help us, oh Lord, and to be able to just whatever the Spirit of God has for us tonight, we want to accept it. Lord, we rebuke and bind any hindrance, and we release, God, the Spirit of God that would be here, Lord, to be able to answer, heal, and fix any issues that are coming in here tonight. God, you're the healer. You're the deliverer. God, you're the one that has set us free.
Yes.
And tonight,
yes,
Lord, we depend and trust in you.
Right.
We thank you, Lord, because there's victory in Jesus.
Yes.
We praise it, and we thank it.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to turn it over to Brother Scriber, and we're going to get started here. So hang on. Tie your seatbelt. We're going to have a good time tonight.
Yes, we are.
Brother Scriber.
Well, how many of you are excited to be here tonight? I think we can do a little better than that. How many of you are excited to be in the house of God? We're going to get started tonight. We've got some congregational songs we're going to do for you. We'd love for you to stand and join us. And we're going to just let God have his way. We're going to enter into his presence tonight. And if you came bound, depressed, and tormented tonight, you don't have to leave the way that you came tonight. Amen. He is in this house. He's been with us from the very beginning, and we're expecting even more tonight. Amen. How many of you came expecting the Lord to move tonight? How many of you came with something on your heart that you need God to touch you tonight? He can do it right here in this house tonight. Y'all just praise the Lord with us tonight.
Grab you a red back candle and turn to page 300. You know what? One of these days, real soon, we're going to see the King. Amen. Thank God. The Bible says that absolutely nothing can take you out of his hand. Now, it doesn't matter what it is. It names off physical. It names off all these things that we face and that are here. And none of them, not even death, can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. I'm going to tell you what. I can't think of anything else in this world that can do what Jesus did. Amen. You ever thought about that?
Yeah.
Nobody can do what Jesus did. Let's say we are going to see the King.
Page 300.
300.
It's the bearers of the
Yeah.
Because you're set free, he's coming. Amen.
Amen.
I want you to think about something just a second. Oh, we had a big prayer tonight, but can we just have church?
Amen.
I want you to think about what in the world you would be like if God hadn't saved you. Exactly. But my mind lets me into retaining thoughts that God done such a wonderful thing by blotting all my sins out. And he makes me not remember those things because they're of no avail. They don't help me one bit to think about it. And that freedom of liberty that God has given us through salvation, you have to experience it, because all you can do is tell somebody about it. But once they get saved, they're like, man, I wish I'd done this a long time. Amen. Amen. It's the grace of God. You know, the Bible talks about happiness, but it talks about joy. Joy is different than happiness.
Amen.
You can be in your lowest state of your life, and you can still have joy because of the Spirit of God that lives in you.
Amen.
When you think about what David did, David was down and out. When they come and robbed him and took his wife and kids and everybody else and took all their stuff, and he encouraged himself in the Lord and went down to Ziklag and took back what the enemy took from him. And I'm telling you tonight, we are child of the King.
Amen.
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 We got to declare who we are sometimes. I'm a blood-bought, born-again child of God. I don't know why I'm saying all this, but I feel God tonight.
Amen.
I feel Him every night.
Amen.
Amen.
But you know, the anointing of the Holy Ghost will help you in your life.
Yeah.
It will.
Amen.
If you don't have the Holy Ghost, let me tell you what you need. It will help you so much. Let's thank Him. Praise God. Amen. Once like a bird in prison, I'm not afraid to
You know, people, I hear people say, you said, I need the victory over this. And I'm like, you've got the victory. You've got the victory. If your name has been written down in the book of life, you have victory.
Hallelujah.
We need, as Christians, to minister to one another. Amen. Where else are you going to give it at?
That's right.
The world ain't going to give it to you.
Amen.
It's a good thing to go up to our brothers and sisters in the Lord and pray for them and encourage them and tell them how much you love them, how much they mean to you. Amen. And I'm going to tell you, when you're doing that, the enemy is going to fight you. And you're going to be on that fire line. But you know what? I have decided. I mean this with all my heart. I have decided that God is able to bring you through whatever. Amen. He told me just the other week ago, I said, Lord, I said, I'm so stressed out over this thing. And I said, I just want to be honest with you, God. He said, I would never open the door for you to do that if you couldn't go put it in. He said, it ain't too big for me, so therefore it won't be too big for you.
Yeah, that's right.
And I thought, I said, wow, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me, Lord. I was thinking about Alan. I wasn't thinking about you.
Come on.
Amen. Maybe that'll help somebody.
Yes, it does.
Maybe that'll help somebody. It ain't about me sometimes. It's about God.
Amen.
That's right.
Just take step by step and don't look so far out there, but right here in front of you. Let God help you. We're going to sing Keep on the Fire in the Line. You'll get some shots out of that. You hear me? You may have to get in that hole once in a while. 212. 212. If you're in the battle for the Lord,
when we see the souls that we have helped to win.
Glory!
Lean into Jesus from the past of sin with a shout of welcome. We will be on. I'm telling y'all, and you know it as good as I do, we're getting ready to go home. Amen. But just like Sister Teresa has been preaching, there's a job to do while you're here. There's a responsibility as Christians to tell the world what's right and about Jesus.
Amen.
And Jesus is what's right. So if you preach in Jesus, they're going to live right. They can get right. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be saved. Praise the Lord. Shake somebody's hand. Tell them it's good to see them tonight. This song that I'm going to sing, no shame on me. Amen. Shame tried to tell me to keep looking back. You held me captive to the pain of the past. Regret is the whisper you had. Satan's a liar, I know. Thank you.
child of the King. I'd rather be here than any jail cell that there is in Polk County or Highlands County, amen?
Amen.
How many of you excited about being here tonight? Let me tell you what, God's still God. He's still on the throne. He's still a way maker.
Amen.
Amen. He's a chain breaker, amen?
Amen.
There's so many times where you get discouraged. How many of you get discouraged from time to time? And you get in that old pity.
We don't want to
get in that old pity party. How many of you know that it's okay to get in a pity party every now and then? But it's all right when you step on that devil's feet and tell him to get away from you. He has no control over your life. It's time that we start speaking life into our situation. Amen? That's right. I've been seeing so many pastors saying negative things. How about saying a few positive things a few times, and maybe things might turn around in your church?
All right, right. Yes, amen. Come on.
I'm just going to leave that right where it's at. But I'm serious. I've been seeing some things. How you going to tell me about Jesus when you can't even say hello to me at Walmart?
Come on.
Seriously.
Come on.
How many of you went to Walmart and witnessed to someone lately? I dare you to try it. I dare you to try it. I'm going to tell you something. You don't know what someone's going through. You don't know what valleys that they've been through. You don't know what kind of day that they've had. There's been times in my life where I was at the bottom of the bottom of the bottom, and somebody walked up to me at Walmart and said, God says He loves you. Whew. Y'all didn't hear that. God says He loves you. There ain't nothing that can come against you if you're a child of God.
Amen.
And you just don't ever know what someone's going through.
Amen.
And that one very thing that you might say, even in a Walmart or Walgreens, picking up your medicine. Don't tell me you don't go to Walgreens. I know you do. It's either Walgreens, CVS, Publix, or Walmart. Y'all get what I'm saying tonight?
Yeah.
We have a lot to be thankful. If you're above ground and you're breathing, you still got hope. And I tell you what, you have a voice. It's time for you to start speaking. How many of you know that sometimes you go through some things, and sometimes you don't understand why you go through them, and it doesn't make no sense, but later on down the road, God will send somebody your way so that you can testify to them and tell them about what your scars. You see, it's time for those scars to speak.
Come on.
Because you don't ever know what you've been, what you went through, what you're getting ready to go through, or what you're coming out of. But I'm here to tell you tonight that God can take every situation and He can turn it around.
Yeah.
Praise God. I don't know where that come from, but somebody tonight needs to hear my voice. You're a child of the King. You are a child of the King. I'm going to say it a third time.
Yes.
You're a child of the King.
Yes.
And it's time that we stand up. Amen. Just like Sister Teresa said last night. We got a voice. It's time for us to speak. Amen. So if you've been through some scars, you've had some things that's come against you, you've went down some trials and some tribulations, and somebody's going to come your way. Somebody's facing what you faced. And somebody's going to be able to hear what you have to hear.
Amen.
That's right. Or what you have to say.
Amen. Amen.
And those scars that you went through are not in vain. Mm-hmm. God's going to use those scars to turn it around. Amen. For someone
Amen.
Else.
Amen.
That's right.
Praise God. You know, I don't have a huge testimony. I was drugged from church to church to church to church when I was a kid. I used to tell everybody I was a drug addict. I was a drug addict for Jesus. There wasn't no choice. If you lived in my mama's house, you was going to church every Sunday, every Wednesday night, every Saturday if there was a sing or a revival, you was there every night. I remember going to Faye D's house, Sister Dale's sister and being there till 4 o'clock in the morning. My mom said, I know you gotta go to school in the morning, but it's all right, you'll get up. And I'm here to tell you, if it wasn't for people like Faye Deeds and Dale Latham, I don't know where I'd be at tonight. That woman right there sold into my life. See, she was my neighbor. And she took care of me while my mama was out working a 3-to-11 shift, and I come home from school. She made sure that I had food. She made sure that I had the things that I needed until my granny came over, and then she set me off straight. You going to bed. It wasn't no ifs, ands, or buts about it. You going to bed. But that woman right there sowed a lot into my life. And I thank God for praying mamas. How many of you have praying mamas? I don't know why I'm saying this tonight, but I feel so strongly I need to say it. Thank God for praying mothers. I remember at 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning, my mom would come in there and she'd slide her hand on my chest and I'd be sound asleep. And I'd wake up and she said, it's all right, son. Just going back to sleep. I'm just praying for you. And she'd go to speaking in tongues and praying. And of course, I couldn't go back to sleep. And she would literally pray for me for hours at my bedside. And you see, that's why I am who I am today. Am I perfect? Absolutely not. I make mistakes. I get frustrated. I get aggravated sometimes, but it's all right. Amen? But we have a lot to be thankful for tonight. I'm going to ask Jack and Teresa to come on up. They're going to sing a song for you. Have y'all enjoyed this revival? Yes. I want to say thank you to Pastor Robert for opening the door for us. We have thoroughly enjoyed being here, and it's great to see God moving in a powerful way.
Amen.
But we just want to love on him tonight. Would y'all make Jack and Teresa welcome tonight?
Step, oh, how true.
go further, I want to go ahead and, I haven't done this yet, I want to introduce everybody to you. Everybody knows Sister Tony from last night, Sister Teresa, but I want to say a special thank you to Robin Deal from Frost Creek Church of God. Y'all make them welcome. Back here on the guitar, his name is Scotty Baxter, his wife Valerie right here. They just got a brand new granddaughter yesterday. Back there right in the corner, that's my other half right there, that's Amanda. She's doing a great job over the last few years. Y'all make her welcome. Over here on the right, it's Mike.
Sister McGowan.
And Mike McGowan. There we go. I'm terrible with names. Y'all got to forgive me. But they are with Sister Tony, and they came over from Cape Coral, and he's doing a good job on the sound tonight. Let's make them welcome tonight. Yeah. Sister Tony's got a song she's going to sing for us, and I tell you what, if you were here last night, you got to hear some great worship. If you wasn't here last night, you're going to get to hear some great worship tonight. Amen? Amen. Y'all make Sister Tony welcome from Cape Coral.
Glory, glory, glory. It is a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having us again. I am so excited about what's coming. I've been praying for this. I've been praying because I know that God gave you another word. I don't know what's coming, but I know it's going to be amazing. But I know when stuff starts happening for me, there's only one place I can go. There's only one place you can go. And that's it. You go to the right. Crank it up, Mike.
Go to the rock. I go.
to the rock. I adore.
Dealing with her husband, and all of that happened, but you know what? This is a refreshing weekend for you. I can see it all over you. God is boosting
this
weekend. If you love Sister Tony singing, don't forget she has a table set up in the back, and I know that she would appreciate it if you take something home with you. And she's got some t-shirts back there, some videos, some CDs. If you'll see this young lady right here on the front row, she'll take care of you. Just make sure that you pay for it before you leave. We're going to take a break real quick and take an offering up. I'm going to ask Pastor Robert if you would to come. We appreciate everything that you did last night for Sister Tony. That was such a blessing. She's traveling for a long way to get over here to Cape Coral. But we also appreciate the offering that you're giving each night for the ministry. And I want to tell you real quick, we do have a Facebook page. It's Worship in the Word Ministries. If you'll go on to Facebook and like that page, you can follow what we've got going on. We've got several concerts coming up, and we've got the next one is in 3 weeks at my church, His for Life Ministries, Avon Park, on October 12th. Everybody you see here will be there, as well as Sister Tammy Renee. And if you don't know who Tammy Renee is, she's a fantastic sister in Christ. She does a wonderful job, so we'd love for you to be with us. It's going to start at 10 o'clock.
You enjoyed yourself so far tonight?
Yes, sir.
Both of you are here the last 5 and 5 4. You know what church is going to be 3 weeks old. She left the Lord have it. The Lord takes her.
Oh,
seek you.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember years ago I used to throw myself on the floor and I would scream out, "Kill me, God!" And then I thought, I better not say that too loud. Somebody might call the paddy wagon and think she done lost it, she gonna go kill herself or something. But what I've learned is if I don't die, if my ways don't die, if my ideals don't die, if my desires don't die, he can't live through me. The only way he can live through us is if we die to ourselves. I have a mandate on my life that God just put on my life recently. And I'm going to tell you what's the truth. This worship is awesome. You can't get into worship in here, you can't get into worship anywhere. Amen. But I have a mandate on my life, and it's going to cause people to part from me, and I know that. They're not going to like what I have to say, and I know that. It's going to cause some enemies, and I know that. But I have a mandate that God put on me, amen, and I'm going to stand with the mandate that God put on me.
Amen.
And two nights ago, the Lord, or 2 days ago, I had been studying, some of y'all know this, all week I've been studying for a message, and I had it all wrote down, and about 2-3 hours before service started, the Lord spoke to me, and he changed everything around. And he said, it's time for the church, for God's people to know the truth and to hear what thus saith the Lord in this hour right now. Amen. Yeah. And if you're going to a church or a place and there's no move of God, can I suggest you get out of that place and you get to a place where the Lord is moving by His Spirit. Amen. You don't find the Word of God everywhere. He said in the last days that there's going to be a shortage. Amen. And we're living in that time. Amen.
Yeah.
That there is a shortage on hearing the Word of the Lord.
Yeah.
We're hearing a lot of preaching. Amen. But we're not hearing a lot of Word of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And I'm finding out that there's a lot of preaching going on, but it's not the Word of the Lord because there's no anointing there. Let me get to my mandate before we get started here. Amen. I need a 1, 2. Got you. You got it? Now the Lord spoke to me, and he told me the four corners of the church each night. And we're going to do this simply because God said to do it. I don't care how foolish you think it is. God said to do it, so we're going to do it. So on all four corners of the church, we have a scripture that we're going to read, and y'all know it, and you can just quote it with us tonight. Amen. But this is just what we're going to do because we're in trouble in this nation.
Yeah.
We're in trouble in our churches. Amen.
Yeah.
So we're going to read this and go ahead and start it out. If
my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins. Will heal their land.
This is night 3. Go ahead again.
If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land.
One more time, night 3.
If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And now there are four things in that scripture right there that we have to do. Number 1 is being humble. Humility. Number 2 is to pray. Number 3 is to seek. Number 4 is to turn. Number 4 is to turn. That's the one we all leave out. You know, like I told you, everywhere I turn, lately, anything I hear when I'm listening to my preachers and all this, they're quoting this scripture right here. That's why it lets me know this has to be taught to the church. You know, on 9/11, that was the scripture for the country.
That's right.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
That was the scripture for the country on 9/11. And right now, I mean, it's a return to this scripture here, amen, because we're at a pivotal point in the country. And unless the church rises up and begins to use her voice and her authority, we're going to be in trouble. Amen. Listen, we don't even realize the degree of trouble that our nation is in. We don't even see it. Some of us are asleep. And if we don't wake up and begin to pray and seek God, amen. Listen, some of us don't even have a prayer life. Because we're so busy. Or we're lazy. I mean, I know this is a little bit bold, what I'm saying here tonight, but we have got to wake up. We've got to. We have no choice. So God put this on my life to read this scripture everywhere I go and let the people know, hey, our nation's in trouble. We've got to cry out to God. We've got, I said, what if we have a mass prayer meeting where we all come together? I remember years back where I was visiting, once a month they had a worship service on a Saturday, the first Saturday of every month. And God began moving through this. They had this, the state seat, whoever these people were that came actually to the meeting. They were Christian people, government people. And what they would do, they had a big screen up, and they would put up on the screen the things that need to be prayed about over our city and over the nation. And the person that had the burden for whatever was on the screen would come up and take the mic and begin to pull down strongholds over that area. And they'd done it night, you know, they'd done it for months, and each one would come up. I mean, they would have up there, you know, about the children and the schools, and they would have up there abortion. They'd have up there, you know, our nation, the states, you know, our governors and our mayors, and they would have all these people up on that screen, and different ones come up. You know, that's what we should do. And if you have a burden, you come up and you just start pulling down the strongholds and casting things down and taking authority over these things. This is what we got to do. And I know what I'm saying is just going over some of y'all, and it's kind of boring some of y'all. But I'm telling you right now, God's calling the church back. Amen. It's time that we get back to our original mandate. Amen. And that is that we rule and that we reign in this land. Amen. We are the kingdom kids. Amen. We are priests and kings to God. Hallelujah. And what we say does matter. Jesus. I was standing there thinking about the Azusa meeting. And I remember Seymour, blind in one eye, black man. Y'all know the story, some of y'all do. But he would get up on the pulpit and cover his head with a box. I asked God right there, because none of y'all have any idea how I feel right now. You have no idea. Me, of all people, standing here with a mandate that God has put on my life, of all people, you have no idea the people that are out there that are against this girl right here.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Ha, ha, ha. Let me tell you something. God brought me this far.
Yes, he
is. I've had some bumps in the road, but in the last week, there's been such a shift in my own life and in the ministry, and God done it himself. Amen. Not one person is responsible for what God is doing and what he's going to do in your life. Amen. I'm telling you right now, don't look to anybody to pull you up when you're down. Amen. If you get in your closet and you begin to pray and seek God, God will lift you up himself. Amen. He deserves all the glory. He deserves all the praise. It's all about Jesus. Amen. 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 Don't rely on people. Amen. To get you where God called you to go. Hallelujah. People will be a stumbling block to you. They'll get jealous of you. They'll begin to cast you down. They'll talk about you. Amen. They'll run you down. They'll say you're no good. Amen. But let me tell you, everybody that's in this house tonight, God called you. God ordained you. I want to hide behind the pulpit, man. And we come in here, we have so many fine people, fine ministers, you know. And I say, God, why me? Why? You know? I say, God, why? Why? And the Lord just let me know, you got the mandate on your life.
Yes. Yeah.
So that's why I'm doing what I'm doing.
That's right.
Come a long way, baby. So today, God gave me a word, and when y'all started singing, there was a song y'all were singing, I thought, oh, Jesus. You know, it's just confirmation. Every night, it's just like a confirmation, you know. And it's about the anointing. I don't know who sung it. You started singing about the anointing. Somebody did. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You can always tell if somebody's been praying. When somebody sings, gets up and sings, this has been good. This has blown me away. But if there's been no prayer in private, I said in private,
yeah.
There's no public appointment. There is a private anointing that comes in the prayer room. Before it's a public appointment.
Amen.
What you do in secret, God rewards you openly. If you're not praying, I don't care how long you've been saved. If you're not praying in private and have an intimate relationship with Him in private, hallelujah, don't come into the house of God and expect, amen, that God's going to use you and move through you. You've got to do something behind closed doors. Getting up in front of people. Amen. If you don't pray in private, don't get up and expect to get on a platform and God anoint you and move through you. You've got to pray in private. I want y'all to picture this right here. 17-year-old boy. He's in a meadow with a bunch of sheep. I was picturing this today. He's in a meadow with a bunch of sheep with a harp.
Oh, come on.
He don't have a crowd. Not a lot of people around listening to what he's doing. But he's in a meadow. He's all alone with a bunch of sheep. And he's singing. And he's, you know, because David wrote these songs. They were songs. They are songs that he's.
That's right.
Bless the Lord. Oh, my soul. He's out there in a meadow with a bunch of sheep all around him.
Come on.
And all that is within me, bless your holy name.
Yes.
I believe that God seen this young boy and it grabbed his heart. Because he wasn't doing this in front of people. He was doing this all by himself.
All right.
And I was picturing all these little lambs all around him and how peaceful it must have been out there in that meadow with him singing and worshiping God. But that very thing is what grabbed the heart of God. And what grabs the heart of God is when he sees somebody that is locked up in a private place. Maybe it's your bedroom, your bathroom, in any closet. I don't care where it's at. But what grabs his heart is when somebody is alone in a private place and they're worshiping him, not expecting anything, not asking for anything, but just saying, God, I worship you for who you are. You are mighty. You are God. There's none like you. You're my Savior. You're my Redeemer. Look where you brought me from. Nobody did this but you. You're the one that has anointed my life, God. You're the one that has appointed me, God. You chose me before the foundation of the world. And here I am today, and been chosen in you, secure in you, and washed by the blood and filled with the Spirit of God, and just worshiping God all alone.
That's right.
Amen. Amen.
was like, God, hide me. Hide me. Don't let people see me. But let the words that I speak, let them hide me and pierce their heart. I pray to God that these 3 nights that we have been here, that something sparks inside of you. I pray that something sparks inside of you. You want the anointing in your life? You've got to start paying the price for the anointing. It doesn't come cheap, amen. It's the divine power of the Holy God we serve, amen. So I begin reading this about David today. Because you know that Israel was not even satisfied having God as their leader. They wanted a king like all the other nations. They wanted flesh and blood. There was a time that God, he wanted to come down on a mountain and visit with his people. But when it started, the lightning and the thunder on top of the mountain, and Moses was standing there, and he says, don't be afraid. He's wanting to commune with you. He wants to talk to you. But they were so afraid of what they see that they backed away from it. They told Moses, no, we don't want him. This is my version. We don't want him to talk to us. You talk to us. You be the mediator between us and him. They were afraid of God. And that's where some people are tonight. You're so afraid, amen. But I'm here to tell you, he's a peaceful God. Amen to the Lord. So they wanted a king. You know the story. So Samuel went to God and told God, this is what they said. Samuel was the prophet. They want a king. And God told Samuel, so Samuel, they're not rejecting you, they're rejecting me. And I want you to tell them what they're going to be underneath a king like this. So he goes through this whole thing. Y'all go read this in Samuel. He goes in here and all of these things that they would become having a king like that. So they raised, they anointed Samuel to be king. I mean, his first assignment, he failed. His first assignment, Samuel said, wait 7 days, I'll be here in 7 days. And we'll make our sacrifice in 7 days. Are you on board?
No.
Preach it.
So, before 7 days was even up, Samuel was afraid because the people started partying because the Philistines were going to come to war. And so he was afraid. So he gathered the people and he made the sacrifice himself. Which you do not do.
That's right.
Only for the prophet to do.
That's right.
Samuel did it anyway. When Saul got there and he seen, he said, what have you done? Second assignment for Saul was 2 years later. He said, I want you to go. The Amalekites were the ones that hindered Israel when they were coming across the land. He said, go in and slaughter every one of them. Everyone. I mean, they don't leave nothing. What do they do? They go in, they war against the Amalekites. Samuel comes. They save the king and the best of the flocks. He comes. Saul was so proud. And he says, we've done what the Lord told us to do. And he says, you did? Well, what is this bleeding that I hear in my ears? They saved the king and the best of the flock. Second failure. Disobedience. Amen. God said, I've had enough of Samuel. Of Saul. I'm sorry. I've had enough of Saul. I have a king set aside that is a king after my heart. That is your neighbor.
That's right.
I don't think Saul quite caught that. He said it's your neighbor. Hallelujah. Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
So I'm just trying to get through this story real quick. We're just setting a little foundation here. So, he told Samuel, he said, I want you to go down to Jesse's house. I want you to go down. I want you to go down, take a kid. You're going to have another offering. Because at the time that Saul was king, the Lord told Samuel that I'm going to anoint another man. Okay. So So let's just get this lined up right here. So Saul, the Bible says that Samuel didn't see Saul again till the day of his death. So Saul wasn't openly okay to go in and just walk in where Saul was present. So he goes in there with the reason of having another sacrifice. So when he goes in, he says, I need the house of Jesse. We all know the story how he called his sons before him. He had 8 sons. And he called the sons before him, and they all lined up. And the scripture shows us that Samuel walked up to the first one, Eliab, and he tells us that he must have been some kind of a man.
Amen.
For him to say, surely this is him. And the Lord spoke to Samuel. He missed it. This is the prophet. He missed it. God did not say he was the one. And so he says, he's not the one. You're looking on the outward appearance. He says, I look at the heart. Amen. So he goes to the next one, on down to number 7. He looks at Jesse and he says, is this all your sons? Now here's a prophet. You know, he knows there's got to be something wrong here. And so he says, is this all your sons? And he says, well, I got one more. He wasn't even invited to this meeting. Come on, somebody. He wasn't even invited to this meeting. And he was out there in the meadows, amen, with the sheep, tending the sheep, amen. And Samuel told him, he says, we're not going to sit down until that son comes. So that somebody ran after David and told him to come. I was just imagining today how these other brothers were feeling. Why was Samuel here? What was he here for? And he bypassed all of us. And he wants to see the last son that is nothing to the family. He's a nobody to us. That's why he's out there. And so, well, I mean, if there's somebody that's going to be anointed, why is it one of us?
Exactly.
They go get David. Here comes little David. They say he was a ruddy little fella. I don't know. Pictures show him having red hair and, you know, just a little ruddy fella. Say he was about 17 years old. What's that?
With his heart.
With his heart, yeah. Here he comes. Here comes David. And when Samuel seen him, the Bible says that the Spirit of God spoke to Samuel and said, this is him.
Amen.
And here's all these big brothers standing there. Samuel walks up to David and he pours the oil and it begins to flow.
Amen.
This is him.
Amen.
Now let me tell you something. Even though David was anointed, that they didn't know the degree of what this was about. They had no idea. Because David was anointed king that day. This was his first anointing. He was anointed king that day and went back to the sheep. He was anointed king that day and didn't govern over anything. Hallelujah. That was the first anointing. David's had 3 anointings in his life, and we have 3 anointings in our life, how we walk with the Lord. This first anointing was among his family, and don't you know that they were jealous? They didn't know what this was all about until later on. And do you know that David was in the back fields with the sheep? Hey, you know what? Let me just drop this in here real quick. I read that in Israel, that when the shepherd, that he may be in the container, whatever you call that, eating, drinking, whatever, and all of his sheep were out there, and all of a sudden that shepherd can walk out that door, he'll hit. The shepherd, the sheep know that shepherd's voice. Listen, another man can walk out there and do the same thing, and they won't move. But when their shepherd walks out and says, hit, here comes all these little sheep. And they may be grazing out there, but they hear something. Hit. Their head just raises up and they take off running after their shepherd. Amen. But you know something I read that's real interesting is in the desert over there is that at night that they take and they build up a round wall with all that that tumble stuff. Y'all know what I'm talking about? What you call that tumble stuff? Yeah. Rocks, and they'll get by a rock area, and then the rest of it, they'll tumbleweed, you know, whatever, and put the sheep inside there. But there's an entrance right here, and the shepherd lays down right near the entrance of the door. Did y'all get that? The shepherd lays down at the entrance of the door so the sheep can't get out. He's our door. Hallelujah. They're protected from all of the prey that we try to get sheep, amen. He protects them. Nobody can get in, and nobody's going to get out, amen. Are you thankful tonight for our shepherd tonight? Hallelujah. He is the shepherd and the door of the sheepfold, amen. He protects you, and he keeps you from all harm, amen. You got to understand who you are. And the sheep know him. And the sheep know his voice. Listen to this. You know, David, like I told you that, his first anointing, where's my other paper? Oh, Lord, let me just go by memory now. That's no good. Here we go. It was 13 years before David was king. 13 years. Brother, you may help me out here if you know this. 13 years after being anointed that first time before he became anything. And it wasn't really the fact that he was king. He was just anointed to do what he done.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Amen. The second time that he became, it was 13 years from the first to the second anointing. The second anointing anointed him. They anointed him among the tribe of Judah.
Glory.
Glory.
Mm.
Glory.
Glory.
Yeah,
yep. I wish we had that.
Right.
I would dance like David
danced.
With the Spirit of the Lord, this is David in the town of Judah. Who's on my heart? I will dance like David danced. With the Spirit of the Lord, who's on my heart? I will dance like David danced. Experience with God.
Yes.
Your experience will come in your secret place.
Amen.
Your fear of man will leave in the secret place. Revelation will come to you in the secret place. I hope you're understanding what I'm saying. You want a platform and a place to preach, but you don't pray. We don't fast, we don't pray, we don't seek God, but we want something more.
Yeah.
I want to see His face.
Right. Amen.
I'm not satisfied where I am.
No.
Brother, I sit and I listen to worship, and it tears my heart to worship Him. There's a place that I desire to be in Him, a place I've never been. I've been in places of worship that was really deep, where the anointing was so strong on me that I fell on the floor and couldn't get up, where I felt my flesh was melting. Oh, this is the truth. I don't make this up. I was melting to the floor. And I it's really comical because I thought about the Wicked Witch of the East or whatever she was. How she began to melt down. Y'all remember that? I know that's just the best way I can explain. But I felt myself melt. And I went down and I couldn't move. I couldn't get up. The Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and He said, there are many in this place that need deliverance tonight. I said, and I was on a one-on-one conversation with Him, so he talked to me, I talked to Him, and I said, Father, I said, God, you got to back off of me some. I can't get up. I can't get up. So I kind of felt a little bit of strength coming. I looked over at the lady pastor over there. I said, would you come help me? Please just come help me. And I said, the Lord just spoke to me, can I obey God? And of course, yes. And she's holding me. And I said, there are people in this place tonight. The Lord just spoke to me that you need deliverance. If you will come, He will deliver you tonight. And when you walk out those doors, you won't even battle that thing anymore because the deliverance power is in the house. God said it. No, I didn't say it. God said it. So this is your time to come if you want deliverance. And I'm telling you, they came up to the front. They threw down cigarette packs. Amen. And God delivered people in that house that night. Amen. It was a move of God that I experienced that night that I've never experienced in my lifetime. And I want to go back there. But the Lord told me, you're not going back there. Where you're going will be greater than what you've ever experienced. Where you are now is not where you're going to stay. Everybody hear me tonight. Hear what I've got to say tonight. Where you are now is not the place that you're ordained to stay in. Amen. Where you are now, some of you are going through some battles. You're going through some troubles and you don't know what to do. That is not a place for you to stay. Amen. Valleys are made to walk through. Pressure is made to make you strong. Amen. Pressures come. Listen, you'll never get oil out of the dry olive. Amen. They got to take and crush that thing to get the oil out of it. They got to put pressure on that thing to get the oil out of it. The pressure is coming on your life to get the oil out of it. Amen. To fill you up. We want to be like Tiny Tim. Gently down the street. The way of least resistance. I don't want problems. Well, I'm sorry to tell you.
Come on.
We want to float.
Mary. No problems. I feel so good. I'm not having any issues, no troubles. I mean, I go to church and I sing. I lift my hands.
for me out of church.
Oh, come on now.
You separate yourself from people.
Come on.
Man, I should have left that thing out. I know it again, y'all. Oh, Lord Jesus, help me find this. Somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Guys, we're not through that. We're going all over the place up here. Oh, what is the anointing? That's my other page. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I probably left that thing at home, you know? I probably did. But if I can find it right here, I won't read it to you because it was really interesting to me, but I know I can't find it. It's not here at home. Okay, so let's just get back to what we're talking about. So, David had his first anointing among his family. His second anointing, the Bible says they anointed David over Judah. That place of worship. That place of praise. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So your first anointing, it comes when you get born again. You know, and things happen when you're born. It's kind of like when we were talking about pregnancy, those first 3 months, that first trimester. That's a very important place right here that you're very careful, that you gently walk. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So we get that first anointing, then in the second anointing, all of a sudden you begin to get filled with praise and worship. I mean, it's like there's an anointing that just come on you. You want to praise, you want to worship, you want to sing to the Lord. And if y'all haven't experienced this, and I'm important, y'all like crazy out there, amen, you need to experience the second anointing. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so we found out that it was 13 years from the time he was anointed in front of his family. 13 years later, he's anointed in the tribe of Judah. And then here we go, 7 years later after that came his third anointing, that he was anointed king over Israel. Hallelujah. He was anointed king. And that just took me back to the kingship that we have with God. Amen. He said that I have made you priests and kings. Takes me back to the fact that we are in a kingdom. Amen. And God ordained a kingdom to rule over the earth realm. Amen. And that's a revelation that we don't have, that we need to learn. Get in the scripture and learn that we are kings with authority in the earth realm. I have told you over and over that we are at a pivotal point in our country and in our church. And it's time again that the church arises and takes her place. And I'm telling you right now, I don't care where I go or who I talk to. Amen. My mandate is to say this right here. Arise and shine, for your light has come. You're not in darkness tonight. Your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. It is time, church, that we declare and decree the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody lift your hands. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. That ain't even what I want.
Hallelujah.
I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord.
Amen.
So, the time we're living in. This though also, I read part of this last night, didn't finish it. In the last days, perilous times will come. How many know we're there?
Yes.
For men shall be lovers of their own selves. Oh, Lord Jesus, help us. Covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent. That was the word I wanted to get to. Incontinent means no restraint. There's no restraint. When I was leaving to come to church tonight, I told y'all I have this news break thing on my phone. Sometimes it's an aggravating thing, but I was seeing the thing that it was saying was the mother of that boy that went in and shot all those kids at that Appalachian school, that the mother, her own mother, she had taken her and she taped her up to a chair and left her and would not let her get up from that chair. Without natural affection.
Yeah.
It also, that's incontinent. You have no restraint. What would cause a 14-year-old girl to come to her back home to her mother, and she's in there resting in bed, and go into a room and pull out a gun and go shoot her in the face. What would cause somebody to do that? That's incontinent, no restraint. What would cause somebody, amen, to get on a roof over there somewhere while the president is over there giving a speech, our ex-president, our soon-to-be president, and he's over there giving a speech, and they got a gun aimed at him, and they begin to shoot, and people died that day. That President Trump's ear was pierced. We all know the story. And then what would cause somebody to go on his golf course and put a gun through the fence, amen, waiting for him to get down there, and thank God that the service man got there first, amen. But there is no restraint in our land anymore. Somebody gets mad at you, it's so easy to go home and grab a gun and come back and shoot you. I was reading, we're at a fast food restaurant. Two men got into an argument. One man walked out to his truck, come back in and shot the man. What would cause this? It's a spirit that's in our land today, and the church has got to rise up. We've got to begin to speak against this spirit. Amen.
Amen.
My God.
Yes.
No restraint. Fierce. Despisers of those that are good. You've got enemies, whether you know it or not. Well, not everybody I don't understand why they don't like me. I just don't understand. You take it personal. It's not personal. And it's not even you. They don't like what's in you. When you come around, devils start. It'll start up. It should be that way. It should be that way. Watch this, traitors. They're traitors. Petty, high-minded, lovers of pleasures, more than lovers of God. How we have it in the church.
Come on.
Having a form of godliness. This is why it's in the church. But denying the power thereof.
Amen.
From such, turn away. When you begin to speak against the things that are going on inside the church, it stirs up those religious devils. Amen. Yes, it does. I've seen people walk out of the church and leave the church simply because somebody that had the anointing in their life came in and preached a message that really hit them hard, and they left, they were offended, and never came back. Amen. And that's what they should have done. All scripture is given by inspiration of God.
Yes, right.
And it's profitable. Listen, it's profitable. It's going to profit you. For doctrine, for reproof, for correction.
Amen.
Yes.
It's profitable that the church be corrected.
Yes.
For instruction in righteousness. It's profitable that the man of God or woman of God may be perfect or mature, is what he's saying, so that you'll be mature and you'll be ready with all good works.
Amen.
Preach the word. How many preachers in the house? Woo! Look out. Preach the word.
Amen.
Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove. Now, look, these are words we don't like to hear. You know why? Because we're not dead. You are not dead to your flesh. If you can get easily offended, that means your flesh is ruling.
That's right,
amen.
Oh, that's a whole nother level right there.
Amen.
Oh, my gosh. If what you can say to me hurts me, offense is hurt. And if what you say to me can hurt me, then my flesh isn't dead.
Man.
Isn't that another level that we don't understand? Well, I think you're the biggest hypocrite. Listen, I know your past.
Come on.
I went through a season in my life where, you walk through this place of shame of things that you've done when you come to the Lord. There's things you don't want people to know about you. You don't want them to know where you've been and what you've done. And you carry that thing with you through a season because God's not going to let you keep that.
Yes, Lord.
So my sister, Faye, she had a dream one night about me. And when she told me about the dream, I said, oh my gosh, I'm transparent what I'm saying right here. I would go to churches, and I visited a lot of churches, and I would always look at the door waiting on somebody to come in that knew where I had come from. And it would hinder me. I carried this for so long a time. She had a dream that I had a box, and I got it at home. I had a box in her dream. I would come into the church, and I would hide that box underneath a pew. Inside that box was the word shame. Because I was shamed from what I had done. The people I hurt, the things that one decision in my life caused me to walk down a road that I didn't know the price I was going to have to pay. I stayed longer than I wanted to stay. I paid more than I wanted to pay. I was there. I remember, and I'm really being transparent right here, that I remember that I walked outside one day, and you know, I don't care what you say about this right here, God knows, and God has forgiven me. I looked up into the skies because I told God, I said, God, I want you to leave me alone. And he did. For 12 years, no conviction, nothing. I done my own thing for 12 years. Went to my places I wanted to go for 12 years. Then I had a dream. Because I knew somebody had to be praying somewhere for me to have a dream like that. It was from God. I knew it was from God. But it was a warning. In this dream, I was standing outside and I looked up into the sky. As far as I could see, it was black. And there was like this cyclops creature looking thing. And he was flying my way. Everything behind him was devastated. It was black. It was burned up. Twisted his head around and he looked down and he looked right at me. And all of a sudden I heard a voice say, when I see the blood, I will pass over you.
Amen.
You have no idea. That was a change for my life. I went into my room. I pulled out my Bible. It had been in the closet for years. I never got rid of the Bible. I got rid of the books, not the Bible. I pulled that Bible down and I opened it and I said, I know I've preached that message. I have preached that message sometime. I opened the Bible and it was in Exodus where he said to put the blood over the lintels of the door and the sideposts. And he said, I'm going to send the death angel through the land. Amen. I do believe that had I not heeded to that warning that night, I would not be standing here tonight. I would not be standing right here with a mandate that God has put on my life. Wake the church up, amen, and get us back to our foundation and the truth of where we should be, amen. Hallelujah. And he said this right here. And we read in the scripture where the death angel came and all the firstborn were taken out, amen, from the cattle all the way down to the sheep, all the way down to the turkeys and the chickens. The firstborn was taken all the way up to the palace, amen. He took the firstborn out, but it was the blood that protected the Israelites. The children of God are protected by the blood. You're protected by the blood tonight. You sit in this place and you've accepted Jesus Christ. He's your Lord and He's your Savior. You're protected by the blood of Jesus. Amen. Don't take it for granted tonight. Amen. He chose you. He ordained you. He called you. He's God. It's not a man. It's not a woman. It's Jesus Christ. Amen. He called you. I'm pulling you out. I'm pulling you out. I'm pulling you out. You don't have to stay where you are. Devil is a liar.
Yes.
And one thing I appreciate about God, when He forgets, He forgets.
Amen.
Yes. I was a supervisor at a plant, and I was sitting in the office, and a man walks in. I didn't know he was a preacher, a pastor on top of it. And he goes, he sits down, just, I guess just kills some time. Man, we had a Holy Ghost meeting last night. I was vaccinated. And I knew what he's talking about. He said, Holy Ghost. I was like, really? You know? I'm like, this is something touches you. Don't know. It don't matter how far you get from God, there's something that's still a little something in there. You know what I'm saying? It's like a little precious part, amen, that you tried to cover up. But when you heard that word, Holy Ghost, it just rose that thing up. I said, really? You know? Do you know that 2 years later, after that meeting that morning, because he was telling me where his church was and invited me to come, and I said, well, you know, I had already told God, I don't want to do this, you know, I don't want to do you, just leave me alone. And I went through all of that. It was 2 years later when I had come back to the Lord. But what it was, I woke up one morning. I had my son, he's 2 years old. And I woke up and I said, we going to church today. He would go, touch. Time to time, you know. Love babies, man. And we got ready, got in the car. So I'm looking for a church to go to. And I drive and I park in front of his church. But there was, and the sign said Church of God, but there was nothing that said what time they start. So I'm sitting there, but there's something in me says, this is not it. And listen, y'all, I ain't making this up. The Lord spoke to me. And he says, remember the man that came to your office, told you where his church was? And I said, yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. So I didn't really know exactly how to get there, but I went in the direction I thought it was. Y'all, I found it. I pulled up in that parking lot, and honestly, I am telling you the truth, my heart was going, boom, 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 boom. I knew something was about to happen. It was like, oh, 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 oh. And I grabbed my son. I walk inside. This place was full. There was 2 seats left on the back.
Wow.
It was for me.
Yes.
Because God knows, if it was in the front, I would not have stayed. I'm the type of person, I'm going to sit on the back pew. Every church I go to, I sit on the back. I don't want to sit on the front. I don't want to be seen. I was looking for a box tonight to put my head on. That's just me. So I walk in and I sit back there, and they're doing the worship. Back then it really wasn't worship, you know. It was just more singing, you know. But anyway, it was all good stuff. And a lady got up and she sang this song. If I could, what is the last thread of hope? Y'all know that song? Anybody know that? You never. Well, anyway, it was a song I never heard either. But it was the song that God ordained for me to hear that morning. Because when she sang that song, something broke inside of me. She finished up the song. She walked by me and she says, God has something for you here tonight. I'm squalling now. It broke. I felt the fountains just, everything lifted off me and it broke me. And there was a lady, this is when they had the holiness ladies, you know? They had that bun on their head. And you know what I'm talking about, the holiness. And she had this, she was sitting right there and I'm sitting there and I'm crying, you know, I'm trying not to let people see me cry. And I'm holding my son like this, I don't want people to see me crying. And I'm sitting there just squalling like a baby and she taps me. And she says, honey, would you like to go up there? And I'm like, and she says, well, here, let me take your son to the nursery, to the back. And of course, my son, he's ready to get away from mama. So I go to the back. Listen, I went to that altar. And with everything that was in me, I said, Father, I've been away so long, Brother Gary. And I said, Father, I knew he was my father.
Oh, yeah.
I said, Father, I'm so sorry.
Yes.
Because I stood 12 years earlier and I said, leave me alone. It's kind of like the prodigal son that went away from us. And he went away. He actually really lost his mind because the pig food looked good.
Yeah.
He got me ranged up here. And I said, forgive me. And, you know, I've heard so many testimonies of people saying they felt something lift off of them, or, you know, just something happened, da-da-da, and I'm like, by faith, I believe that you forgave me. I got up and I walked out of that church that night, not feeling anything. I didn't feel like I was even saved, but I'm going to tell you what I did. I said, God, I know the scripture says that I have an advocate with you, and his name is Jesus. And if I confess my sins, that you are faithful to forgive me of my sin. And he forgave me. I took it by faith. I was a supervisor then at this place I was working at, and I took my boombox with me. That's when I had boombox cassettes and stuff. But y'all are telling how old I am tonight. Yeah, just 10 years ago. I took my boombox, and it was Jimmy Spider. We got cassette tapes, and I put that in it, and listen to me, I blasted it. I blasted that, and my department heard all about this music. And they heard some beautiful singing. Clean. Good. Not country. Like they were playing. Not no rock stuff. Good, clean singing that made you feel good.
Amen.
So I was walking along. I ain't making this up. I was walking along, and the music was playing, and it was some upbeat song that came on there. He was singing. You know, Jimmy didn't really do a lot of upbeat stuff, but he did this day. It was on this tape. And I'm walking along, and all of a sudden, this is the best way I knew how to explain it. There was a little champagne bubble on the inside of me. I knew it was in my spirit, man. It was a little champagne. It was that new wine, right? You know what that's about. It was that new wine. It was a little bubble. And I felt it. All of a sudden, that bubble came up out of me. And I'm going to tell you what. It was like fire that was shut up inside of me. It burst. Everything I knew lifted off of me at that moment. There was no shame on me. There was no condemnation on me. I felt no guilt from then on. God had delivered me. He had set me free. I couldn't go by what I felt in the beginning. So I took it by faith. God, you said it. I'm going to believe it. I might not feel it. Amen. But you're working. Even though I don't feel it, I might not see it, but you're working. So you say, I prayed. Well, listen, it was 2 weeks later, right after that, man. I went back to the same church. He let me preach, and I was running across the chairs. I mean, I was running across the chairs. I felt the fire of God inside me. I'm telling you, there was no devil in, he wasn't nowhere to be found. He couldn't be in the building for sure, amen. Hallelujah. I knew from then on, he was under my feet. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. You need to stand up and tell the devil that you're under my feet. You're under my feet. You're under my feet. Some of us like to wear a saddle. We like to wear a saddle and let him ride us for a while. So I was preaching. It was 2 weeks. I was back preaching in the fire of God. There was deliverance. I mean, the house was on fire.
Yes, amen.
Glory,
I just took that.
And I told y'all last night, if you weren't here, but I told you last night that this is a birthing month for me. Mm-hmm. And it is you. It is for you. I never knew this lady, but God brought a connection here. He's birthing something.
Amen.
There is a move of God that is coming that's going to be greater than we have ever seen. There's an anointing about to be released from the heavens. I can tell you tonight, if you pray and you see God, you've got to make some changes and adjustments. You've got to make an alignment in your life. We, we've got to quit being busybodies and busy with everything else, amen. And we've got to begin to pray and seek God again. You did it one time, you can do it again. God is a God of restoration. He wants to restore the ministry. He wants to restore your hands, amen, that you lay hands on the sick and they recover. He wants to restore your voice, that you begin to speak this, saith the Lord, and it's going to happen, amen. There's an anointing. I decree that tonight I feel the anointing of God. There is an anointing that is about to be poured. It's a vial. There's a vial up in the heavens right now, and it's beginning to waver. The red bosanda is beginning to waver back and forth. It's at a tipping point. It's at a tipping point, and it's about to tip, amen. And those that will pray, and those that will seek God, and they that return to their first love, amen, he's going to pour an oil out upon you that you've never had in your lifetime. I'm the second. He's going to begin to stir up the gifts inside of you. You begin to prophesy. You begin to lay hands upon the sick. You begin to declare, thus saith the Lord. I feel the Spirit of God. Come on. I want you to come on up here. I want you to come on up here. We need to anoint some people tonight. Amen. I don't know where you're at. I do know where some of you are tonight. Amen. I do know that if you will heed this word tonight, God is going to do a work in your life that you've never experienced before. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. We've been hearing it every night that each night is catapulting into the next service. Some of you will experience something tonight that you have never. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't have the baptism of the Holy Ghost and you speaking in tongues, you need it. You need that. You need to build up yourself on your most holy faith. That praying and the Spirit of God.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Let me tell you what happened. People were driving by said that the Holy Ghost got a hold of them and they had to turn their car in. We had a couple that came in and they said they had a dream and they seen the church. They had to come to the church. Amen. Listen, it's going to happen again. Amen. When the anointing is restored to the house of God, there's going to be people that drive by that can't help it. Amen. There's going to be a pull back into the house of God. This is real. Know how it's going to be tomorrow night because we are catapulting. Like the Rams, I was watching the Rams on the side of the mountains. How they climb? I mean, straight up. Woo. I was like, that's what we're doing. Yes. We're climbing. And each night, it's getting more powerful and more powerful.
Right.
Amen. I can't wait to see what tomorrow night's going to happen. We might come in here tomorrow night, none of us be able to stand up.
Come on now.
Come on.
So what I want you to do between now and tomorrow night, I want you to pray. How many will tell me that you're going to pray and you're telling me the truth? Amen. Out loud. Pull down strongholds from the north, the south, the east, the west. Amen. Call them in from all areas. Amen. The four winds of the earth. Hallelujah. We call them in. Call deliverance. Amen. To God's people. Restoration is in the house.
Yes.
You can all stand. Amen. I appreciate so much y'all coming and Edna and Mommy. I love you guys, man. It's so good to have y'all here tonight. Amen, Brother Jesse. Good to have you back tonight. Brother Gary, sweet wife. And you too. You got it? Amen. Amen. It's so good to have everybody here. Appreciate you coming. Bearing with us. Being patient. Amen. God is good. Let me close this out. Just everybody lift up your hands and thank Jesus for coming into this house tonight. Thank you, Lord, that your spirit came in, that you delivered and you set free. You restored, God. You restored people to their first love tonight. Now there is something that is igniting your people, and it's the fire of God. And I thank you for that. We're going to come back in this place tomorrow night, God, expecting and knowing that you're going to be here. Amen. Give the Lord a big hand. Praise the Lord.